I don't like working with urethane. I never really have. But a few bat buddies needed something, and I said, okay.
Hey, bat buddies. Paul Roberts, RT1. Today, we're going to do something a little bit different. I had two bat buddies within the last month or so that just had to have a urethane belt. And I don't work with urethane. Latex will last years. But urethane, once it's opened, if you're not careful, you might get a couple of weeks. I'm not insane. I don't do the same things the same way, expecting different results. I don't want to waste all this, so I went ahead and ran every single thing I was going to run until I was completely out and got about 10 or 11 belts out of it. Now, I'm not saying I'm going to do this again, but I wanted to get it right this time. And now I got some things to fool around with, some urethane belts. One of the bat buddies did a trade. It's pretty cool. We're still working on some things. Might do a mannequin one day eventually if I get the chance to do the tactical vest that we're talking about possibly doing. He wants to put together a costume. I have some handcuffs here. Got a handcuff pouch coming. And a holster, which I'm going to use for one of my prop guns. Well, I'm fooling around with a new concept here. We take this blank belt, and we have various things that we can put in there. Glue on, screw on, whatever. Resin, urethane, whatever. I'm going to be fooling with that more as I go along. This is the drawing table where my father worked. He's alive and well, but I brought it over here. I had Alfred bring it over here for me. And I have a story that I'm going to tell about this drawing table another time. I'm going to fool around with this, I think, for myself. Just take this really nice black begins belt and do some special customized things with it. And I want to do something with these belts. A little experiment for a video today. Now, the only person I know of that's done this successfully with urethane, other than to use professional skin flex paint, which is very expensive, urethane paint, is a bat buddy that I knew from the old Brother of the Bat. And he successfully stained a belt like this and gave it a more, not aged, but like more three-dimensional look. A lot of times these belts are kind of flat. This one's kind of the mustard color. Is kind of like a more yellowy color from 89. And sometimes I'll use gold and silver and different metal qualities inside the making of the belt. But today, just for fun, and if you're watching this right now, it probably means that it came out okay. I'm going to go over to the table and do some paint techniques on urethane and see how that works out. Non-conventional paint techniques on a non-conventional medium. And we're going to talk about that as we go along. So let's go, bad buddies. Let's head over to the table and go ahead and see what we do. No, I'm not going to lash through this above on something and go swinging over. I'll just walk today. Couldn't resist. All right, we're going to take this belt and do some things with it like I normally do with latex. But in a very considered manner, I'm gonna tell you how it goes. If you're watching this, it went acceptable. Otherwise, cutting room floor. So we have these metal particles. Okay. It can be a very expensive way to make a belt. And I'm sure some of you are familiar with the ways that they especially worked on Batman Forever and Batman and Robin. Hey, wasn't that great the other night at the Oscars? There were five Batman people there. So Schwarzenegger comes out with DeVito, and I go, oh, the twins! And then I'm thinking, I'm not thinking Batman. Can you believe I'm not thinking Batman? And then they tell their little Batman jokes, and Christopher Nolan's out there, and Michael Keaton. And of course, the guy that won Best Actor was Scarecrow. I just can't get that out of my mind. You know, I haven't seen that movie, but anyway, it was hilarious. So this is going to be an irregular belt. And the reason I've chosen it is got a couple of little things here that aren't perfect. So I'm gonna fool around. Yeah, I'm gonna fool around. All right, so this is the way you buy stain, because stain can be expensive, okay? You wait till a guy on your street that's a cabinet maker his whole life retires, and you buy every one of his cans of stain. Once you shake them, make sure they're okay for a buck a piece. And then you go and buy all the products that he has that are in gallon containers for a dollar a piece too. And when you spend 15 bucks, you got, not a lifetime supply of stain, but a lot of stain. So let's start off with some of this, and we're gonna go from there. So let's go up top. All right, I work on a marble slab, and it's kind of dangerous.
using stain, but I'm going to be careful. And I'm going to put, I say dangerous, it's like, if I had a black splotch on this, it would be gnarly, you know, to look at every day. I don't know his last name, Paletti, I think it is, Paletti. I know his last name, but I don't know how to pronounce it. From 20 years, over 20 years ago. So Michael, he was a good bat buddy. Some of them disappear from the scene and you just don't see them anymore. Yeah, stains are expensive. They're like, gosh, what are they, like $15 a piece now? That's crazy. In the interest of caution. So I'm just gonna fool around a little bit. Let's just talk about this because we talked about, we're gonna use a little consideration here. Does anybody know, hands please? Why, like I'm making messes already and I need to start it. Why we don't paint urethane, or why we really shouldn't or can't paint urethane? There's a number of reasons. For one thing, it's very slick and not very porous. Paint doesn't necessarily want to stick. This is why I'm fooling with this one, because for some reason I had a problem here. But there's another reason, guys. And the reason is it outgasses. So if you do skin flex paint, which is urethane, that is just like another coat of urethane, and the idea is that the outgassing will go through both, okay? So I'm going to do a couple of things. I'm going to nod to Michael. I'm going to go ahead and fool around with this a little bit. And then I'm going to do some spray paint techniques, because my thought is, just like I say, you know how the spray paint is holding hands and it'll still flex. My thought is the outgassing will go through that too. Okay. So the question is, how can we get this to where it needs to be, or where we would like to be creatively with it, without causing the outgassing to be trapped underneath? What happens when the outgassing gets trapped underneath is you get bubbling. And that can be a real problem because it'll ruin the thing. I could have gone with a black urethane belt to do this experiment. And I do have some blacks over there. But I never would want to take it all the way to gold, because what would happen is, it's working pretty well. All right. I just want to punch it a little bit. And I'm going to probably come in with some browns, too. You know, most caves I know aren't windy. But you can hear the wind today. Santa Ana winds. I got a couple of little vents up there at the top. A fan. And whenever I'm doing something that's dusty or whatever, fumy or whatever, I'll run that. So the wind is blowing those things. I really like it better because it's, you know, got a little more dimension to it. I can't go with a black belt and get it all the way to yellow or gold. You'd be going backwards anyways. Everybody knows black belt's as high as you can go. And you start off with whites and then yellows and then golds and... Okay, anyway. All right, so I'm going to take another stain. This is actually some dye. I've got it in here with the stain. Might as well throw that in because what I'm doing today is I'm just fooling around. All right, Michael, what kind of thoughts were you thinking all those years ago? I'm going to go a little bit overkill. Anyway, what I was saying is if I went black, I'd never get it all the way to where it needs to be. Oh, that's too much. See, this is why I start on the end. That is just too strong. Now, I'm going to go ahead and dilute that. I don't care what happens behind the cape, but I've never done this. I've used dye on a black cowl, but I've never used dye on urethane. Wow, this is a new way to do this. If I diluted this dye, I could change that color a lot. Shoot, I like that so much. See, this is what I like to do sometimes, guys. When the camera's not on, but I'm doing it right now and the camera is on. I actually am changing the color of this, and I know it's gonna stretch just fine and it won't affect the outgassing. I'm gonna get me to a different color to start off with. So I did black dye on a cowl recently, just for fun. But I've never done dye on urethane. I don't work with urethane very much, like I said, the head of the video here. And I just don't like it. For instance, like right now, you know how they say you can't use latex things sometimes at hospitals? I've had bat buddies tell me that. So a lot of people like to use the urethane. Because I think it's because of latex allergies. Hello? People aren't probably going to know they have urethane allergies because most people don't ever fool with urethane. I'll go get a little bit of stuff going on here so it's not all uniform, because we're never going to be uniform. So I'm going to go back over and do this exact same thing again with this dye. If I went all the way black, in the beginning, I'd never be able to put enough light colored pigment on it to get it to where it would be solid enough without it being cracking or trapping the outgassing. But since we went light, we want to bring it down just a little bit so we can work with it. Because what we really want to do is put some of the paint techniques that I do with the latex on top of it when we're done. That's what I'm thinking in my head, even though I've never done this before. I'm going to stop with the dye now. That's enough. That's enough with the dye. We're going too much with the dye. So I'll go ahead and do a little dry brush dye in there just to give it something. All right, so there it is. Let's close that up. That stuff is so strong. It's not going to absorb in like wood. So it's just gonna have to dry on its own, and I don't know how long it's gonna do that. I like to have these things done and while I'm working, and then I say I'm done and that's it, you know. I'd like to get this video done, moving on. But who knows? I might be just, so excited about what kind of results I get and say, I wanna be done, I wanna keep on fooling around, who knows? So I'm gonna go ahead and fool around with some of the stuff I normally do, and I'm gonna see what happens with it. Now, I wanna just have this on there just to get some glimmers, but I don't want to trap any outgassing. You ever notice whenever you get like a drop of paint on your shirt or whatever, you can't get it out to save your life, right? But if you wanted to do like a silk screen or you wanted to do a design on your shirt or whatever, you'd have a hard time getting the paint to stick. So you have to kind of put, you have to do a mental gymnastics. You gotta trick it into thinking, you want this, you want this. I'm messing up. Stick, stick, stick. So basically, I'm thinking to myself, I could have been doing this all these years, but I don't. And there's a lot of reasons for it. There's a lot of reasons for it. But you know, there's one reason for it that I haven't really talked about much, and that is latex shrinks 20%. And you think, well, that's no good. Well, it is with it when you plan for it. If you make the cowl too large when you're working on it, then it'll be the right size once it shrinks to 20%. But the thing is, a lot of people want a larger cowl, and the flexibility comes in, and that issue makes it work for larger people. But you want to start off with a slightly smaller cowl, and I'll tell you why, people. It's because back in the early days, nobody knew how to do anything. I was kind of rare. And so what people were doing is they were getting their hands on things and just, you know, even steal people's stuff, doing whatever they could. What they were ultimately doing was stealing other people's work. And I've had a few people try to steal my things. But not so much. And the reason is because the original is smaller. Only I have the original. Because by the time anybody else would be taking my things, they would have a smaller size than I originally started out with. So that's one of the things that's kept people from taking my stuff. Other than the fact that since the beginning, I was one of the very first and everybody knew me. So they didn't want to get in hot water with people and say, look, this is his thing, you know, because this is such a niche community. You just can't really be doing that. You just can't really be doing it. You really kind of rely on, that's why I started calling them way back then, Bat Buddies. You rely on the camaraderie. You want the Bat Buddies to care about you, and you want to care about them. And there were some people in the beginning that just didn't understand that. And it was a mess. I'm glad those days are over with. All right, I'm going to make more of a mess now, so I'm going to get rid of these things. I think I've got time for one big sneeze. All right, that's a little bit better. All right, so what I want to do now is I want to mist it because it's too brown. But I want to do it only in little tiny particles. I want to catch more of a gold glimmer without going over those browns. Just bring those browns up to a level of more goldish. That's getting there. That's getting there. Barely touching it. I just want to fool with it just a little heavier now with my brush. Really saturate the brush. And just look at it in a more gold state now and say, how can I go ahead and just put more artifacting on there and cover up some of the areas that are a little bit too brown with more artifacting? Kind of consciously think about it. That area is too brown. And this is great because I'm not hardly touching those recessed areas at all. And then one thing I really need to do is pay a little bit of attention to the edges. And I'm not gonna do the edges with the spray. They're not as critical, but I don't want them to be naked either. So when the eye catches that, I wanna have something there. There we go. Flop it around. A little more artifacting on there. Looking good. Nothing's calling out mustard, nothing's calling out brown, and nothing's solid gold. We've got a mixture of a whole bunch of things going on. Now, I really would love to go down on those crevices more, but the only way I can really do it without going too dark and doing it in a uniform manner is to give it a little mist of brown. I could just go over it again, but I actually want to take off a little bit of what I just put down on the top surfaces. But I've got that area underneath there a little bit darker now, which is what I was going for. Now I go back and touch it one more time on the top in a few areas. And I've got the bottom part that isn't being touched staying a little bit darker. And, you know, bronze or whatever it is tends to age a little bit. And wherever you scuff it, it's clean. There's this wall at the National Museum of Washington, D.C. I used to like to go up to whenever I'd go down there from Baltimore, you know, art school. And it's got this point. And, you know, everybody, you know, most things are 90-degree angles on walls. But this has got a point. It's just, you know, different architecture. And everybody thought that was so cool. They'd all go up there and touch it. I'd like to go up and look. And the whole thing is worn down just from people touching it. Have you ever been on the Haunted Mansion at Disney World? You're waiting in line to get in the Ghostmobile or whatever they call it. The very last little bat thing that the little, little ropes hang on. So many people go around that corner to get in their Ghostmobile and touch that thing. But that little bronze bat has had its face completely worn down. It's... Yeah, I love looking at that too when I go by it. It's so fun noticing all these little things. If you have noticed that, put it in the comments. I'd be interested. You know, specifically things I talk about sometimes, I'd love to hear from you what you think about some of the things. Like that one, for instance. There is so much urethane still sticking through there. I'm relatively confident this is going to work. What I like to do is, I like to go in with the hand brush. And I like to look at this up close and just really do just a little bit of detail work. It's not really deep detail work. What it really is just focusing a little better than a Q-tip could be doing or a brush could be doing. And just do a little bit of stuff that is more considered, where you're touching just a certain area and you're doing it on purpose. More mindfully, but still randomly. And you could work with that to your heart's content. I will report back to you and tell you how this goes. And I'll know in just a couple of days if this was a disaster. Because it'll start having anomalies. Now, there's those problems. This is the reason why I didn't worry about messing this up if it didn't work. And I'm just going to let them be. And just say, hey, this is an imperfect. I'm not going to try to do too much battle damage so that that's not noticed. I'm not going to do that. Because this whole belt on a whole actually turned out pretty well. So I'm just going to let it be pretty well with a few defects. And just say, that's okay. That's okay. You know, when he pulled his spear gun off there a bunch of times. Over time, eventually gouged in. The spear edge hit it a couple of times. You know, the spear edge hit that thing a couple of times when he took it off the belt. just a couple of nicks. All right. That works for me. Let's get these gloves off. That's better. So, one last thing. So basically, if you put this around you and you say to yourself, okay, I know how big this has to be now. What I say is, you could just let this be. I mean, this is going to stretch a little bit, but who cares? If you're in the costume a little bit and it stretches a little bit, so what? That's going to make you more comfortable, right? Figure out how much you think you need. Super glue loves urethane. Super glue loves latex. And you're going to put this on there like that. Okay? I always tell myself with every new one of these, this time I'm going to put the lid on every time, and I never do. So, take that stuff off, and you go like this. You're back in business. So I always try to use the pad side. I always try to use the pad side because it sticks better. The pad side down, move it around a little bit. Give it a spritz, and then go to your other side and do the same thing. So we figure, let's see. All right, so there we have a different kind of video today. A urethane belt with basically doing the same things that I do with my other belts with a few differences. And it's so simple. There you have a urethane belt that started out like a mustardy color. There's the original color on the back. I gave it a little bit of recessed darks. Gave the whole thing a hit of some dye. Gave this a little hit of really light brown spray so that the acetone will still come through. We gave everything a little dry brushing. Put the Velcro on. We just simply say, okay, put that around there. Pop it down, and that's how easy it is. Now, I normally recommend putting a piece of Velcro right on your suit where you know you're going to want this, and putting a piece of Velcro on the back of the belt. Why? Because, well, for one thing, you don't have this. But also, whenever you're doing pictures and you don't have an Alfred following you around and you're at a convention, your belt doesn't move to the side or whatever. It's always nice and centered and everything just the way you want it to be, and it's working for you. So there you go. I'll see you on the next video, Bat Buddies. I'm Paul Roberts, Artsy One. And one thing I want to do is tell you my little history story with that drawing table.